IonQ's hype problem is the topic of today's presentation. If you're somebody that's thinking about owning IonQ's stock or you're presently holding IonQ's stock, then you'll want to watch this. So the recent jump in the share price probably has a lot of people looking to see what IonQ news has been released to merit the jump. Well, unfortunately, IonQ is suffering from a bit of a hype problem, as is the entire domain. So in the process of researching this presentation, I came across a Twitter account that posts quantum computing related memes, and I think these two are particularly applicable. So the one on the left talks about the old joke how quantum computing is always 5 years away. The one on the right points out how the quantum community has a much better grasp of what's actually going on, although even the experts can't tell you how quantum computing works or whether we've achieved a quantum advantage, which is why we look at revenue growth as the ultimate ground truth. But you can see how sensible criticism doesn't work so well in the face of quantum hype. Now, we've been covering quantum computing for an awful long time and will publish pieces when there's a lot of hype or when there's a particular event that merits it. We've looked at the three publicly traded quantum computing stocks, Rigetti, D-Wave, and of course IonQ. There are some other imposters that we won't talk about, but we've written 26 research pieces on quantum computing, and that's allowed us to speak with a lot of experts out there, some who come to us or we go to them, and we're of the general opinion that the only way that you'll see something, some notable accomplishment come from any company is if other companies are willing to pay them money for that product or service. And some experts have argued that a company that actually achieves a quantum advantage won't be incented to let others have access to that in the same way that Renaissance isn't selling their trading algorithms, they're using them to generate alpha. He or she who masters quantum computing won't necessarily want to make that available to everyone. Now, the last time we looked at IonQ was in this video that we did. It would have been over a year ago. And since that video, shares of IonQ are down 57% compared to a NASDAQ return of 15% over the same time frame. Now, we don't pay much attention to short-term price movements, but I put this up here just to emphasize that this is a very volatile stock, and you may have thought it was cheap at $14 a share, and you may think it's cheap at $6 a share, but this is a volatile stock that can move downwards even further. Now, quantum computing as a domain, as I said, is quite tricky because the experts can't even tell you if it's working, so you need to pay attention to the only measure of traction, which is revenue growth. Now, IonQ has developed what they're calling quantum computing as a service, or QCaaS. This implies a SaaS business model with appropriate metrics, of which we do not see. Now, what's notable is that IonQ and Rigetti achieved meaningful revenues in 2022, and we consider meaningful revenues to be anything $10 million or over, and that news of IonQ beating their guidance by a bit sent shares soaring. Now, one problem there is the valuation of this company. Now, when you look at these three stocks, Rigetti, D-Wave, and IonQ, we've calculated simple valuation ratio here, which is just the market cap divided by annualized revenue. So you can see Rigetti has the most annualized revenues, and they're surprisingly under $100 million market cap now. Their simple valuation ratio is 4. To put that in perspective, our catalog average of 192 tech stocks we calculate this for is around 6. D-Wave sitting at 12, the smallest of the three by market cap, just $81 million. $6.8 million in annualized revenues gives them a simple valuation ratio of 12. Then there's IonQ sitting above $1 billion there with $15 million in annualized revenues based on their last quarter, gives them a simple valuation ratio of 82. To put that into perspective, the richest stock in our catalog right now for larger stocks above a $5 billion threshold would be Nvidia, actually, with a simple valuation ratio of 28, followed by Snowflake at 20. Now, if IonQ were to enjoy the same valuation as NVIDIA, it would trade at around $2.11 per share. If it had the same valuation as Snowflake at 20, and by the way, 20 is our cutoff. We do not purchase shares of any company where the simple valuation ratio is 20 or higher. That means it would need to trade at $1.51 if it shared the same valuation as D-Wave, 91 cents, and the same valuation as our catalog average, 45 cents. IonQ is overpriced, while the other two names on this list are too small to consider. So when we look at IonQ's 2022 results, we can see this steady increasing revenue over time on the left-hand chart they're showing quarterly. That's great to see. Revenues have cleared $10 million. That's great to see as well. Look at the cost of revenues here. So they have quite a strong gross margin, though they're spending quite a bit of money on research and development. And we'll touch on that in a second. But one thing to note here regarding revenues is you always need to look at where those are coming from. So they make this statement here, and I'm going to read it verbatim. It says, significant customers are those that represent more than 10% of the company's total revenue. Sure, that's pretty bog standard stuff. But then this next sentence is curious. The company's revenue was primarily from three significant customers for the year ended December 31st, 2022. So what they're saying here is when they say primarily, we can assume that the majority of their revenues comes from just three customers. I don't know of any SaaS firm out there that has just three customers, especially when one of those customers is a related party. So a third of their revenues, you can see in the below table here, come from a related party, the University of Maryland. And you can read the previous piece that we did on IonQ. I'll put a link to that in the description of this video, along with a couple other relevant research pieces. But we don't consider for any company, whether that's Ginkgo or IonQ, we don't consider related party revenues to be something that's substantial because they can be concocted out of thin air, more or less. So when you're evaluating this company, the biggest concern, more so than a third of their revenues coming from a related party, would be that they just have three customers. Let's say the majority of the revenues are coming from these three customers. They should specify that. Otherwise, we're going to assume a worst-case scenario. Now, on the bright side, this firm has cash on hand at the end of last year totaling around $538 million. Now, one thing to note that's quite interesting here is that they're not just holding that in cash, but they've made some bets. You can see here on commercial paper, corporate notes and bonds, municipal bonds, and look at the losses there. So they've lost some money on their investment. So they're also noted in their 10K that we looked at, they had some exposure to Silicon Valley Bank. And before all those deposits were assured by the U.S. government, they said that there could have been some problems there. Now, this just comes down to a firm that shouldn't be trying to speculate on the markets. Sure, that's not a very big loss at all, but it's just something that we noted in looking at their financials. Now, what's great about that cash stockpile is that it's going to last them a long time. What we did here is try to look at the cash that they're using in operating activities. So in the past, when we've calculated runway, we just take a look at cash and losses and try to keep it as simple as possible. But it's important to really look at the cash used in operating activities, this line item here referred to as net cash used in operating activities. So the cash they're burning running their business, you could see, is what, around $45 million. That's a runway of over 10 years, right? If they're burning $45 million a year and they have over $500 million, that's a 10-year runway. So maybe an M&A event is in the cards. When you see how Rigetti and D-Wave are getting absolutely pounded, perhaps some consolidation will happen. That would be interesting to see. Now, some other bits and bobs we noted. They talk about supplementing their QCaaS offering with professional services. Definitely need to see a breakdown between QCaaS revenues. This is their flagship product. We'd hope most of the revenues are coming from that versus professional services, which isn't scalable. So in order to increase professional services, you have to hire more bodies while QCaaS can scale itself. Second item here where they talk about incurring significant losses for the foreseeable future. That's just about their R&D spend. And they talk here about the need to achieve increasingly higher number of stable qubits and higher levels of fidelity. These are prerequisites for quantum computing to reach broad quantum advantage. So when you look at these firms, don't assume they've reached a quantum advantage. They're simply selling something that is as useful as other firms are willing to pay for it. And then there's this statement here, of course, you could almost see this one coming. IonQ believes that quantum machine learning, of course, or QML, will become one of the most practical and powerful applications of QC in the years to come. Sure, we wrote about that actually. This was a fair while ago, almost 5 years ago, in this piece, Artificial Intelligence and Quantum Computing, and I'll put a link to that in the description of this video. Now, would we buy shares of IonQ? No, we wouldn't, so let's talk about that. First of all, we'd like to see revenues excluding related party exceed $10 million, and that should happen this year. So you can see here they have guidance that says IonQ expects revenue to be between 18.4 and 18.8, with first quarter guidance being 3.6 to 4. So based on midpoint of their revenue guidance for this year, the most we would ever pay for shares if they hit those numbers would be $1.85 a share. As we said earlier, simple valuation ratio of 20. We don't pay more than that. At a target price of $1.85 a share, however, their market cap would be too small for us to consider at $372 million. We only invest in firms that have a market cap greater than $1 billion. That works out. That works very well to screen out all the chaff and institutional investors. Commonly use criteria like that as a cutoff so they don't have to waste time with extremely volatile firms or firms that haven't achieved sufficient traction. So what would IonQ need to look like for us to be interested in it? Well, revenues of $50 million a year at a market cap of $1 billion would start to look interesting. That would be a simple valuation ratio of 20, and it would also meet our market cap cutoff of $1 billion. That would mean shares would trade around $5 a share, all things being equal. So that's when we would start taking a look at IonQ and thinking about a possible investment. Now, one approach for those people who, as we do, believe in the potential of quantum computing, but who have a higher tolerance for risk than we do, what you can do is, out of the three publicly traded stocks, IonQ appears to be the leader. Now, Rigetti's jump to meaningful revenues is certainly worth a look at, but based on all the research we've done so far, IonQ appears to be the leader out of all the publicly traded names. You need to note that some of the biggest tech companies in the world are working on quantum computing. And that piece, AI and Quantum Computing, that we wrote talks about that. So you also then need to consider all the private companies. There's dozens and dozens of private companies out there working on quantum computing. So you need to consider that as well. But if you're holding shares of IonQ or thinking of holding shares, just buy a little bit every month as time goes on. Because if what we're saying is correct, and shares are outrageously overvalued, you don't want to try and time the market. So there's no fear of missing out here. You're not trying to climb on board the money train before it leaves the station. Regardless of what people on Reddit and Twitter say, just use dollar cost averaging and accumulate over time. Now, just to conclude, we believe IonQ is outrageously overpriced, will continue to experience high levels of volatility as seen in the past. That's the title of this presentation, IonQ's Hype Problem. And of course, the whole domain has a hype problem. If you're a firm offering QCaaS and others are, then we expect to see metrics that reflect that. What percentage of your revenues are services versus QCaaS? Net retention rates, gross retention rates, run rates in general. These are things that are missing from IonQ's decks. So if they're going to be a QCaaS company, then we want to see metrics that reflect that. And as we said, revenues that clear the $50 million mark from more than three clients would make this company start to appear attractive. So I've put up another video that we did on IonQ that also digs into some of the additional details. But before you click that video, please click the Nanalyze logo here on the right. Subscribe to our channel. Thanks for taking the time to watch this today.